HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Broken Things by Lauren Oliver. Performed by Sarah Drew, Erin Spencer, and Saskia Maarleveld. One.
Before we were the monsters of Brick House Lane, before everyone from Connecticut to California knew us by that tagline, and blogs ran pictures of our faces, and searching our names led to sites that crashed from all the traffic, we were just girls, and there were only two of us.
Brynn, now. 5 years ago, when I had just turned 13, I killed my best friend. I chased her down and cracked her over the head with a rock. Then I dragged her body out of the woods and into a field and arranged it in the center of a circle of stones I'd placed there with my other friend Mia. Then we knifed her twice in the throat and five times in the chest. Mia was planning to douse her body with gasoline and light her on fire, but something went wrong and we bolted instead. Here's how everyone knew we were guilty. We had described the crime, more or less, in a fanfic sequel to the book we were all obsessed with, The Way into Lovelorn. Afterward, Mia and I split up. She went home and spent the evening conked out in front of the TV without even bothering to clean up the gasoline that had soaked her jean shorts. I was more careful. I did a load of laundry, hauling ass to the local Bubble and Spin since we didn't have a machine at my house. The police were still able to extract samples of blood from my t-shirt. Not Summer's, but a bit of animal blood, since we'd previously practiced the knifing ritual on a cat, also found in the field. Owen Waldman, Summer's kind of maybe boyfriend, disappeared after the murder and didn't return for 24 hours, at which point he claimed he didn't know anything about it. He never said where he had gone. He was lying, obviously. He was the one who orchestrated the whole thing. He was jealous because Summer had been hanging out with older boys like Jake Ginsky, who was on the high school football team. That was the year Summer started growing up, leaving the rest of us behind, changing the rules. Maybe we were all a little jealous of her. I tackled Summer when she tried to run, hit her over the head with a rock, and dragged her back to Mia so that Mia and I could take turns stabbing her. Owen was the one who brought the can of gasoline and the one too stupid to dump the can after we mostly emptied it. It was found, later, just outside his garage, behind his dad's lawnmower. Owen, Mia, and me, Brynn. The monsters of Brick House Lane. The child killers. That's the story the way everyone tells it. At least a story repeated so many times, accepted by so many people, it has become fact. Never mind that the case against Mia and me never even made it out of family court. Try as hard as they could, the cops couldn't make the facts fit, and half the information we told them was illegally obtained since we'd never even been cautioned. Never mind that Owen was acquitted in criminal court, not guilty, free to pass go. Never mind, either, that we didn't do it.
In books, secret worlds are accessible by doors or keys or other physical objects. But Lovelorn was not such a world and appeared at whim and only when it felt like it, with a subtle change like the slow shifting of afternoon to evening. So it was that one day, three best friends, Audrey, Ashley, and Ava, were bored and hot and decided to explore the woods in the back of Ava's house, though in truth there was little to explore that they hadn't already seen. That day, however, a curious thing happened when they set off into the woods. From The Way into Lovelorn by Georgia C. Wells, 1963.
Brynn, now.
Your physicals look fine.
Polly bends over my file, scrubbing her nose with a finger. A big pimple is growing just above her right nostril.
Blood pressure's great, liver looks good. Normal heart rate, I'd say you're in good shape.
Thanks, I say.
But the most important thing is how you feel.
When she leans back, her blouse strains around the buttons. Poor Polly. The residential director at Four Corners, she always has the dazed look of someone who just got into a fender bender. And she can't dress for hell. It's like she buys clothes for someone else's body. Too tight lycra blouses or too big skirts and man's shoes. Maybe she dumpster dives her whole wardrobe. Summer used to do that. She got her clothes in bulk from the Salvation Army or just stole them. But she could make anything look good. She'd take an old band t-shirt extra large and turn it into a dress, belting it with a bike chain and pairing it with old chucks. Garbage fashion, she called it. She was going to move to New York City and be a model when she turned 16 and afterward have her own fashion line. She was going to be a famous actress and write her memoir. She was going to do so many things. I feel good, I say. Strong. Polly adjusts her glasses, a nervous habit.
6 rehabs since 8th grade, she says. I want to believe you're ready for a change.
Four Corners is different, I say, dodging the question I know she wants to ask. Of all the rehabs I've been to, plus hospital detoxes, sober living facilities, and halfway houses, Four Corners is the nicest. I have my own room, bigger even than my room at home. There's a pool and a sauna. There's a volleyball court on a bit of scrubby lawn and a flat-screen TV in the media room. Even the food is good. There's a salad bar and smoothies and a cappuccino machine. Decaf only. Four Corners doesn't allow caffeine. If it weren't for all the therapy sessions, it would be like staying at a nice hotel. At least I think it would be. I've never stayed at a hotel.
I'm glad to hear it, Polly says.
Her eyes are fish big, wide and sincere behind her glasses.
I don't want to see you back here in 6 months.
You won't, I say, which is kind of true. I'm not going to come back to Four Corners. I'm not leaving at all. I like rehab. I like the whole routine of it. The clean rooms and the staff with their identical polo shirts and identically helpful expressions like well-trained dogs. I like the mottos posted everywhere on construction paper. Let go or be dragged. Live and let live. Have an attitude of gratitude. Life in bite-sized portions. Miniature Snickers-sized wisdom. It turns out that after a first trip to rehab, it's easy to hopscotch. All you have to do is make sure to flunk a P-test right before you're supposed to get out. Then counselors get called in, insurance companies, social workers, and relatives are contacted, and pretty soon you've got yourself an extended stay. Even now that I'm 18 and can technically leave on my own recognizance, it won't be hard. You'd be amazed at how quickly people rally together when they suspect their patient might have killed someone before she was even menstruating. I don't like lying, especially to people like Polly. But I keep the story simple and pretty basic. Pills and booze. Oxy I used to steal from my mom. And apart from the actual I'm an addict part, I don't have to fake it too much. My mom was on Oxy the last time I was home, since some idiot in an SUV rear-ended her when she was coming home from a late shift at the hospital and fractured her spine in 2 places. I get nightmares. Panic attacks. I wake up in the night, and still all these years later think I see the bright burst of a flash outside my window. Sometimes I hear the hiss of an insult, a voice whispering, psycho, devil, killer. Sometimes it's Summer I see, beautiful Summer, with her long blonde hair, lying on the ground in the middle of a circle of stones, her face a mass of terror, or maybe peaceful, smiling because the story she had been writing for so long had at last come true. That's one thing I don't talk about here, no matter how many times Trish or Polly or any of the other counselors push. I don't talk about Mia, or Summer, or Owen, or Lovelorn, or what happened there, how we believed in it, how it became real. In rehab, I can be whoever I want. And that means, finally, I don't have to be a monster.
Lovelorn had its own weather, just as it had its own time. Sometimes the girls passed through into Lovelorn at high noon and found that within the quiet hush of the Terrellin woods, it was all rose and purple, long shadows and crickets, and that the sun was already kissing the horizon. Just as often, when it was cold and rainy in their world, it was brilliantly sunny and Lovelorn, full of summertime bees and fat mosquitoes. One or another of the girls was always abandoning sweatshirts, scarves, or hats on the other side, and being lectured for it later. From The Way into Lovelorn by Georgia C. Wells.
Mia. Now. Holy Mother of Funk. Abby, my best friend, holds up a moldering piece of fabric between two white-gloved fingers. What is this? Whatever it used to be, a jacket, a blanket, an area rug, is now black, stiff with years of stains accumulating and drying, and full of holes where it's been chewed up by a procession of insects. And it smells. Even though I'm halfway across the room and separated from Abby by mounds of books and newspapers, lamps and old AC units, and cardboard boxes containing 100 different never-used, never-unpacked purchases, the kind you order off TV at midnight, blenders and multipurpose knives and Snuggies and even a rotisserie oven, the smell still makes my eyes water. "Don't ask," I say. "Just bag it." She shakes her head. "Did your mom stash a dead body in here or something?" she says, and then realizing what she said, quickly stuffs the cloth into a lawn and leaf bag. "Sorry." "That's okay," I say. "That's one of the things I love about Abby. She forgets. She legitimately fails to remember that when I was 12, I was accused of murdering my best friend. That the first Google result that pops up when you type in Mia Ferguson is an article on a popular parenting blog called How Do Kids Become Monsters? Who's to Blame? Partly, that's because Abby moved here only 2 years ago. She'd heard about the murder, sure. Everyone's heard about it. But secondhand is different. To people outside our town, Summer's death was a tragedy. And the fact that three kids were the primary, okay, only, suspects, a horror unimaginable. But in Twin Lakes, it was personal. 5 years later, I still can't walk around town without everyone glaring at me or whispering awful things. Once, a few years ago, a woman approached me outside the knit kit. I'd been looking at the baskets piled with fleecy, multicolored wool, and the sign in the window, "Make socks, not war," lips puckered as if she were about to kiss me, and spat in my face. Even my mom is abused whenever she has to go shopping or drop off laundry or go to the post office. I guess everyone blames her for raising a monster. At a certain point, it just became easier to stay inside. Luckily, or maybe unluckily, she has her own online marketing business. Since she can order everything from toilet paper to socks to milk on the internet, she can go 6 months without ever stepping out the door. When she announced a few days ago that she was going to visit her sister, I nearly had a heart attack. It's the first time she's left the house for more than an hour since the murder. But then again, she didn't exactly have a choice. After my mom's collections started spreading, first onto our back porch and then onto our front porch, and then into our yard, our neighbors started a campaign to get Mom and me thrown out. Apparently, our very presence was contaminating the neighborhood and single-handedly destroying the chance that our neighbors could ever sell their houses. While the town stopped short of taking legal action against us, they did give us 2 weeks to clean up or face fines for all sorts of environmental hazards. My mom went to stay with my aunt so she wouldn't be in the way, sobbing every time I tried to throw out a used dinner napkin, and I got stuck sorting through 5 years' worth of accumulated trash. "Check this out, Mia." Abby extracts a stack of ragged newspapers from beneath a broken standing lamp. "Now we know what was major news in," she squints, "2014. I hoist a box from the floor, feeling a small rush of satisfaction when a bit of the carpet is revealed. I read off the side of the box. With the amazing slice and dice, kitchen prep is a breeze. Maybe you should sell that. It's still in the box, right? Abby climbs to her feet with difficulty, using a TV stand for leverage. Abby is fat and very beautiful. She has light eyes and dark hair, the kind of lips that make people think of kissing, a perfectly straight nose, just slightly upturned. When she was 10, she started a YouTube channel all about fashion and beauty. By 15, she had 2 million subscribers, sponsorships from major brands.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.